point of the panel discussion was to bring people who have experience with working with malaria and malaria vectors. Clearly, a number of our colleagues have shown data today that's derived from their extensive field work. But we also wanted to have people who have long-time experience in disease-endemic countries come and share their perspectives on the new sciences and specifically this call for eradication of malaria. And so I'd like to introduce to you our very distinguished panel here. First we have here to my immediate left, Dr. Jetsuman Prachumshri. She's from Thailand. She works for AFRAMS, which is an institute, which is a joint venture between the United States Army and the Thai Army, if I recall correctly. She works a lot with Plasmodium vivax, has extensive field and laboratory experience. Our second colleague here is John Guthrie. He's head of the Human Health Division at the International Center of Insect Physiology and Ecology, otherwise known as ACPE. He's also a longtime colleague and has very good experience with working with vectors in Kenya, collaborates with Gwen and myself in a number of ventures here. Our next person sitting here is Andrew Githico. He's also a head of the Climate and Human Health Research Unit in the Center for Global Health Research in Kenya at KEMRI, Kenyan Medical Research Institute, and also has a long time career in malaria research. Next, immediately, we have Hans Herren, who has had a number of jobs. For a while, he was head of ICPE and has now come to working with the Millennium Institute and has a very distinguished career. He's a world expert on the control of diseases and, in addition, not just for human health, but also for agricultural health. And as a consequence, has received awards for his work in alleviating the destruction of agricultural products. And finally, Dr. Pilarita Tongo Rivera, who's from the Philippines and Manila. She's very much interested in malaria epidemiology and the dynamics of malaria transmission. She's head of the Department of Parasitology, the College of Public Health, and the University of the Philippines and Manila, and has both an interest in sort of the evolution of the parasites and origins as they invade new areas, and as trying to develop ways of controlling the parasites. So we'll start with Dr. Prachumshri.
Thanks for Dr. James and Dr. Jan who invited me to this meeting. My major research involved with human malaria in general. I don't have much experience with the other species. But in Thailand, because we have all four major species, and we also have some cases of the fifth species that claim to be another human malaria. So my major interest involved more in the epidemiology of malaria, the transmission, and involved intensively for the past 10 years with the transmission blocking vaccine, especially for Plasmodium vivax.
Good afternoon. My name is John Githure, working for ICPE in Nairobi, Kenya. First of all, I'd like to thank the organizers of this meeting for inviting me all the way from Kenya to California. I think when I came over, or when I was coming over, my friends were envying me and saying that, oh, you're going to see the inauguration of or the person we sent to the US to become the president. But anyway, that is with a light touch. I would like, first of all, to say that the collaboration that we have had between ICPE and UCI has been very, very productive. And what we've listened from Guyan, I think, is just a partial or a tip of the iceberg in terms of what collaboration has happened in between ICPE and UCI. And I'm very grateful that the two gentlemen, that is Guyan Yan and Tony James, thought it wise to bring us to this meeting to deliberate on the issues that I think regards malaria control. Now, very briefly about ICPE. ICPE is an international NGO with a global mandate, but with a focus in Africa. It operates under a 4-H paradigm, which means environmental health, human health, plant health, and animal health. And this was established by Hans Herren on my left here, when he was working as the Director General of ICPE, because he believed that working in a holistic nature is the best way of handling health issues. And since that time, we have been embracing that issue of working in a holistic attitude. And our research, or the research that we're involved in, is basically divided into two, operational research and basic research. In terms of operational research, we emphasize so much on community involvement because we believe that if you don't involve any, the community in any of your interventions, then you're bound to fail. And what we've been doing is to train the communities, especially the scouts that we know are very, very conversant with the geography of the area in terms of monitoring vectors, reporting on issues about malaria incidents or episodes in the community. And we have been able to divide the area that we study in terms of grid cells. And each scout is able to at least monitor the situation in the area. Now, the IVM has been one of our focal points because we believe that silver bullets don't work anymore. And therefore, integrated vector management is what we have been emphasizing on. And we know that some programs in Africa are trying to adopt or embrace that because WHO has also taken up that role. And next December, that is in 2 weeks' time, there will be a meeting in Geneva to just discuss on how IVM could be implemented globally because that seems to be the way to go. We are, of course, involved in larval control, which has been very neglected in the past, and we are trying to emphasize on BTI application and NIM products and also pyrethrum products that we grow in Kenya with funding from the Global Fund. In terms of basic research, we are basically involved in the mosquito behavior because we know that if you know how mosquitoes behave, then you can be able to control them. We know that mosquitoes rest indoors or outdoors, and that's why issues like indoor residue spraying or bed nets work very well because we have understood how mosquitoes behave. Oviposition behavior is another area that we are very much involved in because we believe that mosquitoes don't just oviposit their eggs anyhow, anywhere. We know that they are attracted to those sites by some volatiles that come from those sites, and we are trying to study them. Nutritional ecology is also something that we know that mosquitoes are very, very keen in terms of sugar feeding because for them to be able to fly around, they have to have sugar meal. And we have, in our research, found that mosquito behavior, or sorry, mosquito nutrition has an effect on their survival, fecundity, as well as the parasite infection rate in their guts. So in a nutshell, I would say that we are emphasizing so much on integrated disease and vector management because we believe a single bullet or silver bullets can no longer work. And we collaborate with quite a number of local as well as international partners. And if I may mention the US partners, we have the UCI, we have Virginia Tech, we have University of Miami, we have Tulane University, and we have also the Millennium Institute with Hans Ehren. So in a nutshell, that's what we are doing at TCPA. Thank you.
Thank you very much, John. I must express my most sincere gratitude for being invited to this meeting. I realize it's a very powerful meeting by the people who presented this morning. They are all great leaders in their areas of research. And I feel extremely privileged to sit here and make any remarks regarding what they've been doing and what they've achieved. Nevertheless, we have been in this field for a long time. We have seen hope, we've seen despair, and at this point in my career, I must tell you that this is a point of hope. When I started my career as a young scientist, which is several years ago, probably about 26, 7 years ago. I first worked with Walter Reed, Army Institute of Medical Research. I was attached to their labs in Kisumu. And my first job was to do what is called site preparation for vaccine trials. At that time, there were high hopes that they had sporozoid vaccines. And the only thing we had to do was to go and prepare sites, populations, and you know, in preparation for the testing. It was exciting. And we had no doubt that within a few years, everybody would get vaccinated and malaria would be history. The only problem was we thought we would lose our jobs. not to worry very much, because there were many parasites, intestinal parasites, there were all kinds of other vector-borne diseases, but we thought this one is doomed, it's gone. So we did all that, and then I shifted on to CDC because they too, working with David Caswell's group, thought they had a transmission-blocking vaccine. It was PF something, I don't remember the name. But we were also fairly confident that this vaccine was ready for testing, and so we went forward actually to define which human target would get the vaccine. The idea was who in a human population is most infectious to mosquitoes. It was known from experiments done in the 1950s that it's probably children who are infectious to mosquitoes. So we knew that we were not going to afford to vaccinate everybody, so we thought if we identified the most important reservoir within a human population, that would be the target. So I went about doing my business. It was terrific. It involved feeding mosquitoes on human beings. Sometimes it was difficult because I was not quite sure we had the vaccine. But you had to tell these guys, the only reason we are feeding mosquitoes you know, is because we have a vaccine. Terrible. We finished that job. We published a paper, which became almost a classic. And then we moved on. The vaccine was nowhere to be seen. So then it became very fancy now to study the ecology and behavior of mosquitoes, because the vaccines were having a bit of a problem. Now we had to look for a fashionable new area. So ecology, behavior, this kind of stuff was very exciting. So we did all that. We defined transmission. Some of it was unbelievable. In one site in Western Kenya, we discovered that people were receiving up to 410 infectious bites per person per year. Unbelievable. I mean, this is crazy. From there, then, my friends, research in malaria is like fashion. One time is miniskirts, the next time is bell bottoms, the next time is, afro hairdo, the next time is, skinhead. So if you want to stay in business, you need to know which way the fashion is going. Now, my latest fashion is climate change. That's what we're doing today. And I can tell you, it's a few years ago, this sounded like crazy, but we have seen malaria move from areas where it never existed in Kenya to completely new areas. It has invaded. People don't have immunity. There are no control strategies going on there. And now climate change is becoming a very, very serious issue, which we now have to address. So that's what I'm doing now. Thanks.
I want to thank the UCI for the invitation to be here and also present maybe a bit of a different view of what's happening in the malaria control, and maybe even wider beyond malaria also, because health issues are all connected, as we know. My career path, which started actually at UC Berkeley for a couple of years, where I took on sort of a fighting spirit, working with Robert Vandenbosch, who maybe some of you know him or know of him. He was the guru of biological control. I took this to Africa, where I worked from the east to the west coast on a major program. So gained experience in doing really a continental size control of an insect. And then on with more control programs on insects in agriculture. Eventually, I ended up at ICIPE as the director there. And I was quite flabbergasted to see how little the vector entomologists knew about their vectors compared to the entomologists in agriculture knew about their insects. And so I then decided to boost the vector project at ICIPE, and you heard what's happening right now today there. Very happy to see that a lot of the activities we started in understanding better the vectors their biology, ecology, behavior is ongoing. But doing research, being in the field of the boots, doing research, leading institutions, and also doing a lot of capacity building, I soon then realized that things actually are not moving as fast and as well as they should or could. The reason behind this is that the policies are not right. And if you don't have good policies at government level, I mean at national level or regional, even at global level, things will not happen. And the problems you are in today in the developing countries has a lot to do with bad policies, both from the donor end, the West, as well as bad policies on the other end in the South. And that's what brought me actually to my present job as the leading the Millennium Institute, where we're trying to help people make their own decisions using tools like simulation models, for example, systems models, to actually visualize different forms of future so they can make decisions based on scenarios. And that goes right back to malaria, where I feel that we need better tools to look at the different pieces. Now, this morning and early afternoon, we heard about a lot of very interesting science which is being done, which is building on already a lot of very good science which has been done in the past, and we've seen some actually research done way back. But what impact does it all have? And why does it not have the impact really it should? Now, for one, that anyone is dying of malaria today is a total scandal. Scandalous, because we know, we have controlled malaria in this country. In Mombasa 50 years ago, there wasn't any malaria. And if you look at the map, what something we didn't see, and it was not, the comment was not made, was that the countries where there is malaria today, if you could have overlapped something else there, a map of poverty, a map of underdevelopment. And so we in the West, I think, are responsible for a great part of this underdevelopment. And so we can go a long time doing more research, which I think is needed. Very good research is needed, but at the same time, we have to make huge investments in underdevelopment. We will never, with the best GMO mosquitoes we can find, or best vaccine, deal with malaria unless we also get rid of the underdevelopment in these countries. And I've seen it, I've been there, 30 years of experience on the continent, and I know also that we can do it, if we want to. But that means another set of policy, a better understanding of the system. And I hope now that with the new tools we have very powerful computers who run on a desktop. You can play out the different scenarios. You can work out a lot of data from all this field work which is being done. We heard quite a bit of it today. And I think we could come up with policies at the community, regional, national, and also regional level to change things in a very dramatic way in the near future. So to me, although I'm a scientist also and I know the value of science, I think we need to give a chance not only to the biological science but to the social science. And social science, they have to be part of it, and we heard it at the community level. It's very important to get the buy-in. People have to understand what is malaria, where it comes from, how it actually, what its genesis is, and so they will actually understand it, do something. And there are enough good examples. If only the donors would finally actually listen to it and start to go and see for themselves. In Kenya, I mean, not only do we have what Andrew has done, there's ECPA's work, which was mentioned also, in three different regions where malaria has been substantially reduced, and with a small little additional effort, we could say that it would be gone. So with the present tools, and nota bene, without DDT, we can solve the problem. We can do it better in the future with better tools, but that's not an excuse not to do it right now already and invest the needed money. The loss in Africa every year due to morbidity is what, about $12 billion. All the numbers I heard this morning don't add up to a billion, maybe a bit more. To me, it looks like there ought to be somebody somewhere at the World Bank or elsewhere who thinks that maybe it's time to deal with the malaria problem on the ground so that we don't lose this $12 billion and the economy gets going, and the people can take care of their health, like they did here in America, in Europe, or elsewhere where malaria has been controlled. So I'm really taking sort of more this angle out of experience, because I know it can be done. ICIPE and the foundation, which I'm also running, have demonstrated that it can be done. So what are we waiting for? And I'm sure there will be more questions later on to discuss more details. Thank you.
Good afternoon. It's really an honor for me to be invited here in this symposium. I'm a medical doctor. I graduated from the College of Medicine of the University of the Philippines 25 years ago. And I continue to work for the university. My whole family almost is in the United States, but I choose to work in the Philippines. When I was doing my PhD in Japanese University, in Gunma University, I collected blood samples and blood smears from patients in malarious areas in the Philippines. And what struck me that time is that I should not be only using these patients, but I should return something to them. So at that point, I really thought about it. And so for the past few years now, we've been getting students from Boston University and from Tokyo University, a National Institute of Public Health in Tokyo, who do their field work and who would come to the Philippines to be able to see what is happening. And I hope that some of you here would also take that initiative and would like to see for yourself what is happening, what is going on about the support that you give us. And I would like to thank Global Fund also for giving us support for the malaria control in the Philippines.
Okay, we want to enter now into what I hope will be the most fun part of this, fun in the sense of intellectually stimulating. I mean, I'm going to ask these guys a very direct question. I don't necessarily want to put them on the spot, but I actually do. I want to ask if they actually believe it's possible to eradicate malaria. Now, whatever their answer is, whether it be yes or no, they're going to have to behave as if they did, right? Right? Think about it. All right, so you can give your own personal answer, but one has to behave. But there's a certain uncomfortableness in that, in the sense that how do you really give all your effort? How do you really devote 100% of your energy to something you don't believe in? You know, how do you make this other than just another mechanism to get funding? All right, how do you really work honestly and sincerely toward a goal of eradication where somewhere deep inside, it's not going to happen? So we need actually to think about how this is going to play out. All right, this is a non-trivial psychological event. I don't want to work with people who are going to be self-defeating and say, well, this is never going to happen, but I'll take the money anyway. All right, that isn't going to work. All right, so how do we do that thing we learned as graduate students? Delude ourselves, you know, tomorrow will be better than today. How do we play this out in this global effort to eradicate malaria? And I think what we have to do is, My answer to this is that we have to give ourselves some slack in the timetable. All right? It may not be in my lifetime that we have global eradication, but it may be in the lifetime of the students that are here. And so my answer to that question is that I believe it's possible. I may not see it, but I think it may happen. And therefore, the efforts that I put into it are honest efforts to try to make some impact. But I'd like you to respond for that, and then we'll take questions from the audience. So what do you think about eradication? We'll start with Dr. Jett.
Well, this is my own opinion. I do not believe that in my lifetime I will see eradication. Although I'm not that old, but I believe in control. You know, because when you talk about eradication, it's more than yourself. You know, the very good example, Thailand has a lot of bordering sites, and in certain area we can control. Or even they claim as a no malaria for the past 10 years, so they claim that this is non-malaria anymore. But when we have the problem along the border, you know, is increased, it's come back, not when they talk about clearing, they mean that symptomatic case, but that means there are some asymptomatic case in the area within the past 10 years that never come to the clinic, and then suddenly when you introduce the migrant worker, something like that. So in terms of eradication, we need to have every country ready, I mean, at the same time. I mean, every country that have malaria have to clean out. So that one, I think, is not in my lifetime. But for control, it's possible.
I think you have analyzed it very well, Tony, in terms of when we thought that DDT and chloroquine would eradicate malaria. But we still see the same people who were there in the 50s and 60s who are involved in the campaign still thinking that the eradication is possible. Now, that is about 40 years ago. Now, when we talk about now this generation, whereby we are talking in terms of eradication, Andrew mentioned about following the fashion, and have a feeling that, personal feeling, that we are following a fashion here, whereby donors invited some of those people who are there in the eradication campaign, who now believe that the tools are there, that is the indoor residue spraying, the long-lasting nets, and that the effects of these two would be able to eradicate malaria. So we are following this, I think it's a cycle whereby we had the chloroquine at that time, we had the DDT at that time, now we have the pyrethroids, we have the DDT that is maybe coming up in some countries, we also have the very effective drug, but we are forgetting the fact that we are dealing with dynamic organisms, the mosquito and the parasites. Now, I have a feeling that we are repeating history by saying that we are going to eradicate malaria. I have a feeling that I can go with what you've just said, control. And going stepwise, I think I would recommend, first of all, for us to strengthen health information management system. Because you find that in most of the African countries, if an epidemic occurs, it is usually detected very, very late. And Kate mentioned that if a case of malaria is detected in Washington, or was detected in Washington, I think they were able to contain it within a very, very short time. We are not able to do that. And I don't think in our lifetime we are going to see that health information system that is going to manage surveillance, is going to predict, and is going to manage all those outbreaks. And we forget that, and it was mentioned that if we render the communities non-immune by eliminating most of the parasite prevalence that we have in the population, we are going to develop non-immunities in those communities, and the rebound will come up in a very, very strong way, and many people would die. So the strengthening of the health system research is what I see as a priority. I also see the priority of setting the agenda by the people involved in the malaria control in developing countries. We find that most of the setting of the agendas are set, for example, in Washington, in UCI, without involving the majority of those people who are going to be implementing those policies that are being developed in the Western world. And I would recommend that as many as maybe 30% or 50% of any gender setting meeting should include people from disease endemic countries, because they're the people who understand the problems, they're the people who can tell you, yeah, this can work, this cannot work, rather than being dictated from somewhere in an office and people think that eradication is possible. So in my lifetime, I don't think we are going to have that. In our lifetime, I think we can only manage maybe elimination in some of the areas, but total eradication, personally, I don't think is going to happen in a millennium. In Africa, at least.
I think John is being a realist. I will not be a realist. I will be an idealist. Well, you know, when I was an undergraduate doing thermodynamics, we were taught about the gas laws, and I can't remember what those laws were, but I do remember we were told, beware, this is called the ideal gas law, and there is no ideal gas on Earth. So other things will approximate this law, but they'll never quite behave like the ideal gas. So I would say that eradication is the ideal position. However, there are various reasons which may lead us to doubt that this is achievable. But I think if you take a lower ideal, then your achievement, you know, your achievements will always be slightly below your ideal. So it's safer to take a very, very high ideal so that if you fail, then whatever you achieve is it's much, much higher. So I think if we agree and assume that there is a probability, not maybe a probability, maybe even a possibility that eradication is possible, then we justify it that way. If we fail, we shall have achieved at least elimination in very, very many places. You know, when I started my work in malaria research, in the villages around our campus, the prevalence was 80%. Virtually every child had this parasite in their blood. They were anemic, they were lethargic. It was a terrible position to see every school child sick, and there's not much you could do. Chloroquine was effective. Many of them were asymptomatic, they were just becoming anemic, and so forth. Recently, we have seen those figures of 80% decline to 40% using a very, very unideal application of bed nets. I mean, a rise from 5% to 65% of bed nets ownership in houses, but actually bed net user, the number of people using is much less than 65%, it's probably 30%. Yet, we have seen malaria decline in a whole endemic area from 80% to 40%. In one of the sites where I work in the Highlands, which is hypo-endemic, unstable transmission of about prevalence of 15%, we now cannot, we are finding maybe one case every 2 months screening 100 children. So that means that the prevalence is less than 1%. Yet the methodology we're using is far from ideal. So that's why I still have some hope that, you know, we may be getting very close to eradication, if not just elimination. Now, so why would I have faith in this? So one is this new simple technology that is able to have a significant impact on the disease. Secondly, now we have a very, very serious global commitment to the control, eradication, and elimination of malaria. The world is fed up with this disease. And the world is saying, why can't we kick it out? And I think the world will not rest until we see serious changes in transmission, in malaria control. And then furthermore, the third reason is that the third world itself, there are some improvements in health, infrastructure, in capacity to deal with this disease. You know, several years ago, we were probably no more than 3 or 4 entomologists in Kenya. Now we are probably 20. So there is capacity within these countries, thanks to your training in the Western world, in Europe, and so forth. So things are not as bleak as they used to be. So I would possibly go for the higher ideal. It's maybe not realistic, but if we take a lower ideal, we will not achieve as much. Thank you.
I think I mentioned earlier that where there is a will, there's a way. If people can put, when the Americans put people on the moon, others will soon. Some of them countries with malaria. I think it's possible. The problem is actually not can we do it or not, or should we do it or not. The question is when. And the other one is we have a whole lot of other diseases. Just to remember the opening slide from David Rose's presentation. Malaria is not even the biggest problem we've got. Now, we also have seen from Kate Allman's presentation that the money is actually not really coming through. For promises is one thing, doing something actually about it is something else. So, you know, just to give a simple answer, it's not there. I mean, if you control long enough, as we say, you elimination, and after a while it will be gone. So maybe this century, next century, or whatever, I think that's not really the issue. To me, it looks like what we need to do now is to implement what we know, put actually some of the effort and community efforts done from the bottom up, and implement all what we know. And then I think that we will actually go somewhere already in terms of reducing the impact of malaria, and slowly, slowly we will get there. Because I also mentioned that development has to be part of it. And that's, again, needs more investments, attention of people, policymakers. So I think that if the world would forget about all the other issues, development, all the other diseases, and put all the means into malaria control, sure, it can be done. Or eradication, it could be done. I don't think it cannot be done. And actually, I came up with a plan to get malaria out of Africa, and I think we calculated this at the CIPE for about $800 million, or below a billion, if you do that very systematically. This has to be a Marshall Plan for Africa. You start in Dakar, you end in Maputo. Can be done. We've done other things. We've been to the moon. It's not going to happen. I mean, who and how are you going to get all these people to work together? Even the scientists work together would be a good start, right? I mean, how many different things have we seen here? Well, I can see very few working with others, actually bringing the pieces together and make sure that with the puzzle ends up with the picture of no malaria. So, again, it is possible. Yes, it can be done. But I don't think that people actually will be reasonable enough to get the efforts in that direction. And also because we have other challenges. We're going to have 3 billion more people. And these people will be actually poorer than we have got today, I guarantee you. A few years ago, 20 years ago, we had about 800 million people hungry. Today, it's a billion. Hungry people are people which are also exposed to malaria more than others. Let's be realistic here, I think. We really have to see, you know, what other problems do we have to deal with? How much are people actually really going to do with this? So no matter what great science you come up with, unless it's a silver bullet, which again, I think we all agree that it's not going to happen, I think it's a very long, long-term way down the road that we may get to eradication.
Okay. Actually, the DDT years, 1950s, 60s, and 70s in the Philippines have actually an effect on malaria control, because we have the central group of islands, we call the Visayan Islands, which are malaria-free until today. So the tourists enjoy the very beautiful resorts we have in these islands without fear of getting malaria. But of course, that's totally different from the other islands which we have, which until now are still endemic, like Palawan Island. That's the number one malarious island we have now. With that, I think that it can be done. So what the Department of Health in the Philippines now is doing is that we have a race for malaria-free status. So right now we have 80 provinces, and a total of 59 are still endemic, but we have 21 which have been declared malaria-free. So with that status now, I think, and in the map, Kate's show the last slide, I think, and I was able to see that the Philippines is one of the countries which should be malaria-free in 2025. I hope so.
Okay, I'd like to open this specific aspect then to audience questions and participation.
I've been traveling to the Sudan, and I'm working with several people to open several clinics in the Sudan, and my concern is that this organization or panel of people considered working like Borders Without Doctors, that somehow we should be able to put Sudan on the list and many other countries who have problems, because I agree with what he said. Some of the most impoverished people are suffering a great deal from many diseases, and malaria is one that certainly could be controlled to some extent. So I'm wondering how we can work with that particular forum to have Sudan included.
Well, just what I know about Sudan, because I have some friends actually which are working there. I mean, as you probably realize, you've been there, seen that how little infrastructure there is altogether. And even you go there, it's very hard even to find a place where you can stay overnight unless you go into a tent somewhere. And also the population is very distributed, very sparse, and so I think it creates a lot of issue to have a program to reach the people, to treat them, treat the cases, which I think will be the easiest thing to do in a first instance, because to try to do larvae control or even other mosquito control is rather complicated because of the lack of infrastructure in that country. Now, there's money available. It's not so that, I mean, if people wanted to do something, it can all be done. I mean, there's oil there, there's...
Exactly.
But again, where is the political will to really deal with this? And, I mean, you can almost be cynical and say, well, maybe there's a plan somewhere, and I'll just keep it like this because it's good for certain people. And certain governments certainly don't do anything to help alleviate malaria and other diseases, although they could. They choose instead of enriching themselves, as we know.
My name is Dele Ogunsheta. I'm in the program in public health at UC Irvine, and I want to thank the panel again. The talks have shown that we have many tools in the arsenal, and we can only hope that they work synergistically to support one another toward the goal of control or eradication, as the case may be. But I worry that some of the tools may actually be opposing one another. And the reason I am worried is there was a slide, I think, in Dr. Phil's talk that implied that if you are doing vector control, you may actually be compromising the establishment of natural immunity. So Tom McLean's work seemed to be maybe against the kind of work that may be supported if one accepts that you can let immunity build up to until age 15, 20, and then people become naturally resistant. And I worry that we can be implementing two different approaches that may actually not support one another. And I want to hear if there are field experiences with this, or maybe you want to explain some more.
Yeah, I think you're very right that they could be opposing strategies that we are using because one thing we know that as was shown on the graph is that if you remove the parasite or the parastemia from the individuals and over a long period of time, then you render them non-immune and they become like foreigners and they are kind of bound to get a serious attack of malaria. Now, that's why I was saying that if we don't have a very strong health information system to monitor the epidemics or to monitor the outbreaks of these diseases, then our control efforts might at least be negative in the long run if we are not able to detect and contain these epidemics. So my point here is that we should continue with the available tools because we have the two very, very effective IRS and ITNs, which are very effective. But at the same time, we should also look at issues that can strengthen the rebound of any control effort that we are bound to achieve in any of the geographical areas.
Yes, I think there's some more points that we have to take into account. If you do larvae control, you don't only do larvae control for Anopheles. In most places, there are other mosquitoes, other diseases. So actually, when you tackle the vector, you very often tackle vectors, which I think is very important because it's no good to eliminate malaria and then have another one disease just come in, because we know that open niches really lead to other things to come in. So that's one thing. The other one obviously need a systematic approach. It's not, if you want to control malaria properly, then you have to take this at the regional level. You start in one corner and you do it. And you have to do it so that you don't have this coming back. If not, exactly what you describe will happen. And that needs a commitment. And I think John is right, you know, that with the commitment with communities. I mean, here in America, we have mosquito district in every district, right? So why don't we have mosquito district in every district in Africa or elsewhere? Permanent. The last thing cut out of the national budget, of the community budget, is that line of having the scouts and the people out there doing the monitoring. It has to be there, and no matter what. And so there are a few prerequisites which have to be put in place, but we won't get around it anyway. So no matter what kind of control method you're going to bring in, I think you have to know what you're doing, where the mosquitoes are, where the people are, where the breeding sites are. So all this has to be under control, and not just for a few years, like usually when the song, as long as there's donor money there. No, this has to be built in a way that it will remain after the donor's money is gone and the community takes over. And that's why it has to be there from day one. If the community is not there, they don't understand why they should make an effort.
I'd like to make one comment from most of the country outside African continent. The malaria infection rate considered low but quite stable. So the figure that we see the most is not the death case. You know, we in Thailand and in many other countries in Asia, except Cambodia right now, the mortality rate is quite low. Morbidity is stable. So in terms of control, any control that we implement will keep the situation. But we saw that quite often, whenever the control program, especially the vector control, drop, we see the increase of the case, and we see a little bit more severity, although it's not mortality. So I think in terms of control, I don't think that have adverse effect, you know, especially in a country that doesn't have very high infection rate, but quite stable. And we didn't see the kids get sick very often. That one thing that we see, this figure, we found that in both Thailand, Cambodia, not Cambodia, Thailand, China, the mainland China, and also in Korea. But one important thing that I learned is that, you know, you control and you realize that you have malaria, you still control. But whenever you think that there is no malaria and there's no control, and that's the problem. And we saw that very good example from the Korean, South Korean, when they don't have malaria or malaria, they believe that malaria been eradicated for 20 years. What really eradicate with the malaria is the malariologist. Nowadays, if you talk to malariologists from Korea, they have a very brief knowledge about what really happened in their own country. And that make it even more difficult to implement any control.
In the Philippines, what we see is different from Africa because the transmission is not stable, prone to outbreaks or epidemics. And we see severe cases in children, young adults, and adults. So right now, the primary strategy is early diagnosis and treatment and use of insecticide-treated nets. So these two strategies has dramatically reduced the number of mortalities or death. The results are really impressive, but the number of cases remain. So it shows us that transmission is not very much interrupted by mosquito nets, which is being implemented now. And some insecticide spraying twice a year. So we really have to look into that that aspect seriously. And I think that we have to be very serious with our entomologic research, monitoring, and surveillance, which is not being done at the moment. What we have now ongoing is monitoring for insecticide resistance in the treated nets that we use, but not much in the epidemiology of the vector, bionomics of the vector, and other operational research about the vector in the Philippines, which is Anopheles minimus.
In Africa, I think three examples where there was a very highly successful malaria control programs. One was Zanzibar, Swaziland, then Rhodesia. They had very, very effective malaria control programs where prevalence of disease fell from about 50% down to less than 1%. However, the very success of this program became a problem because the health authorities said, well, this disease is now controlled, eradicated. We have other very serious diseases, let's shift the resources to these diseases, which was perhaps not a very well-informed decision, but it was a decision of good intentions. And what happened is that they had vehicles, pumps, people, these people were laid off, the vehicles broke down, they had bicycles and blah, blah, blah. And down the line, 5 years later, the disease rebound to exactly the same level. The reason is, now this is a lesson learned, and we should not repeat that mistake.
I would also like to ask the panel members to just briefly comment on whether they believe in the possibility of the technologies that were put forward here today. There's two different kinds of vaccine. I'm trying to remember. We have GM mosquitoes, targeted ecological things, IBM. What were the technologies? So if you just, without a long thing, do you believe that these technologies will eventually come to pass and make a difference?
Yes, I do. Pardon?
One by one. Transmission blocking
okay. Transmission blocking vaccine from the study that go on right now is very promising. And one thing that claim to be benefit from this vaccine is that we hope that they will not have a chance to have a resistance, so that will sustain a little bit longer. And at the same time, one thing that missing from this meeting is the drug development, okay, which drug development move forward and then faster. And then it show that failure faster too. The vaccine hasn't really gone to the real use yet. It just like manifest. So I do believe in vaccine. Attenuated vaccine, if it really go to the clinical trial, I hope that we'll see the result next summer. And that close enough. The vector control and in implementation in terms of understand the vector biology, vector ecology is also one of very important. And you can see a big shift if you can do that in the field, which is, it can be very obviously start anytime, but at the same time, it's also very difficult because it's so diverse species of the mosquito. But yes, I do believe that in all of them, whenever available for the implementation and you start that, you see the shift sooner or later, more or less, but every method that have the discussion today will have the impact on malaria transmission for sure.
Yeah, I also believe that vaccines, of course, can work wonders. And we know that from, let's say, the childhood kind of vaccines that were developed and were able to control the measles and whooping cough and all that. But not knowing the efficacy of those vaccines, we cannot at this time comment on their impact. But I would like to look at the recipients, that is the community that's going to at least receive this vaccine. One of the issues that I think should be considered is sensitization of the communities about these new technologies being brought to them, because it will be like what we call a vertical program. You introduce something from a lab somewhere without sensitizing the communities about the ownership of that tool. And what I think I believe should happen at the early stage or the early outset is to try to sensitize the community as these technologies are being developed, so that once they are ready for field trials, then the communities are kind of aware that they're supposed to be part and parcel of the, let's say, participation in the implementation. I'm talking about this because of even issues like IVM, integrated vector management, that ECPA started way back about 6 years ago, still up to date has not been taken up by most of the African countries. ECPA and WHO, we have been fighting very hard to train malaria control managers in terms of malaria control and implementing IVM, but it's only a few countries that have adopted IVM technologies or approach to malaria control. And therefore, I believe that it's going to be a very slow process of these technologies we've been talking about today for them to downstream to the communities, unless we start very early enough to sensitize and to work with them about how we're going to implement them in the end, in terms of once they are finalized. Thank you.
All right. Okay. In terms of vaccines, I think we have very, very few examples in the world of parasites where we have successfully manufactured parasites. This is very different from bacteria and viruses, et cetera, et cetera. I'm not sure why this is, but I understand from those who deal with this business that it's because of the complexity of these organisms. So it is very difficult to predict the future. I mean, the future is not always linear. It could go the exponential way. Tomorrow somebody might make a breakthrough, we don't know. But if we are going to go by the past, these guys have been at this business for a long, long time, and to date, the steps have been rather small. So I would put this as a distant future tool. But it's highly desirable. If we get it tomorrow, that would be great. The same applies to genetically modified mosquitoes. It's a highly desirable tool, but the progress is slow, and given its history, we would probably place it in the distant term sort of position. However, tomorrow, Tony might get the whatever that guy walk in the lab at night and voila.
Vaccines, well, I mean, we've been working this for a while, as you could see. It's difficult. Be nice to have a vaccine. Yeah, so I think that the research should continue. Who knows what they're going to come up with. But like in some other areas, to me it looks like this is type of research which is real, a lot of very basic research, and should not be done with funding comes from development, but from really basic research funding done in universities where we need to train more people for the future also. So to me it looks like it's exactly the right place to do this type of research. Drugs, I think we have to be careful there. What I like to see in drugs is what I didn't see here, but there was a little discussion, or Kate presented something about resistance, and also with the artemisinin. I'm not sure exactly why we cannot go back and use the whole plant material and actually avoid the issues of resistance. Again, ICP has done research on this with partners funded by the Swiss government. And it works, and it will be so much cheaper. And you don't run the problem of resistance because you use the whole plant material. So I think there's stuff there which could be done. Again, to convince WHO to accept such drugs, I think is going to be difficult because we know that's where the problem lies. But that doesn't mean I think we should not look into this type of drugs also. I'll jump on the vector for the time being. I think another one which is important we heard today is on the mapping using information and technologies. I think that's very important because we have a lot of tools today to guide action on the ground, in particular actions against the vector. Now what we still need to know a whole lot more is about the vector biology, ecology. I think we know some, and in the behavior in particular. There's a lot of need there to understand better and really to find where are the weak points in the different vectors. And we have a whole number of species and subspecies. They all actually behave differently, and there's a lot of work to be done there if we want to really tackle, I think, malaria from the ground up. No mosquitoes, no malaria, right? So I think to me it looks like we have to do a whole lot more work there, and also understanding the people's behavior, because we also know that from our work, and you can correct me, John, is that I think about 90% of the mosquitoes found indoors come from within 150 meters from the houses. So it's not the stuff out there in the swamps and God knows where, which is the problem. It's what in man-made breeding sites. So if man can make something, they can unmake it, right? So to me, it's like that's a good place to start. But again, we have to understand much better, I think, a lot about the ecology of these mosquitoes and the behavior. And on the vector control, we heard about new insecticides and you know, the need to find new products, maybe to see how they can be formulated to last longer. All this, sure, very, very interesting and important. But I think it has to go beyond only the IRS. And in terms of insecticides, we should look more into the biocides also. They are pathogens we know are very effective against the mosquitoes, like of the group Metarhizium and even Metarhizium. And again, some work has been done on this already. Maybe even also IGRs, you know, hormones, hormone-like products. or also products which would can modify the behavior, repellents, attractants, etc. So I think there's a whole gamut of areas which we have not talked about today, I think in terms of vector control, which would give us additional tools to do a better job. GM mosquitoes, sorry, Tony, I'm very critical on the GM on the crops already, as some of you probably know, because they don't really have produced more food, and we've seen the reaction of a lot of people in Africa, in developing countries, with a few exceptions. People are very skeptical, in particular when this comes from one place, pushed down the throat of the people, in particular, which has been even the Europeans don't like it very much, and so with GM mosquitoes. I actually suggested to Jeff Sachs when he asked me to go to talk to him in New York, and he wanted my endorsement to release GM mosquitoes in Sao Tome. I said, well, you're going to do this without my benediction, if whatever it's worth. Because if you want to do that, you're going to try to do this in America first. So do your GM mosquitoes here, try to release them in this country, and you'll see what happens. Don't go to Africa yet on another testing ground for something which your own people wouldn't accept. Look at the DDT. This government here is pushing DDT when actually no one would use it in this country. So you can see now, even if you had one, I'm not sure it would actually fly because of the people's reaction. And you know, mosquitoes are a nuisance no matter what. They carry malaria or not. They really don't, nobody wants these things around. And so I'm. You can feel my reticence here to support this. Unless they will just do one quick thing and drop dead, I don't know, maybe you'll find something. But again, not to say that work should not and research could be done in this area, because I think it helps us understand also even behavioral traits of mosquitoes. So I think there's always a benefit of doing research. But to put a lot of hopes there, in particular on the acceptance side, difficult. And certainly, if ever you find a good mosquito, then study the history of GM crops and make sure you don't go into this, make same mistakes.
As a public health person, I believe that the vaccine is the only tool which can really reach the highest coverage, as far as I know and believe. So I really think that the vaccine would be the answer to the malaria problem. I just hope that it will be soon. But in terms of with the different kinds of vaccines, with regards to acceptability to the community, with my experience, I think it would be the anti-infection vaccine which would be acceptable to the people. Transmission blocking vaccine maybe is quite difficult to convince people to accept it. It's really a challenge to make people accept something where they are not the direct beneficiary, but maybe some generations away until they develop herd immunity. So I think it has to be the anti-infection vaccine. With regards to drug development, I am really hoping that we would get more candidates like the antimicrobials. They have a lot, but for parasitologists, we really have very few drugs. That's why I tell my students that the happy thing about parasitology is that you get to memorize only few drugs and drug regimens, unlike the antimicrobials. So I would really like to see a continuous R&D for anti-malarials and other parasitic anti-parasitic drugs also. And for vector control, I think that it should not be neglected. I don't know what are the priorities of funders, but there has been a cycle like. This year, this is the years of the vaccine, and then the years of vector control. And I hope that we don't neglect any of these strategies. So we continue to work on the maybe combination of several strategies and not just concentrate on one. I think that's all what I have to say now.
I think the primate, the malaria in monkey, that the only one that know can infectious to human is so far is P. Plasmodium nosei. But in the area like in Malaysia, very focal, they found many cases. And one thing that they found is just like in human, it's just opportunistic host for that case, because the mosquito that happened to have Plasmodium nosei bite the man that went to the forest, but no complete transmission. You know, although we know that in the lab it's possible, but in nature it's not. So it's just like, not only you have mosquito, you have a parasite. You also may need to have a complete cycle, have to be a man at the right time for that monkey. But in terms of the other species, I guess, because the we know that the biology is completely different. The vector is also not the same. So that's why it is not, we never have any report of chicken malaria in human.
This is Joe Vinitz talking. There's actually a more complete answer, I think. Within the last couple months, Francisco Ayala reported with a group of, with Nathan Wolf from UCLA, that they have another 8 or so isolates of Plasmodium reichenaui, which is actually a chimpanzee, probably bonobo chimpanzee. Malaria parasite is actually the predecessor of falciparum. Falciparum seemed to have radiated from that. And he showed some just incredible data in Korea. And it's certainly theoretically possible there could be a reintroduction. It doesn't Plasmodium reichenaui as falciparum. It's nearly an identical parasite, no question. The data are probably, I think that's a possibility. The problem is that we're wiping out all the chimps. So Plasmodium vivax actually originated as a zoonosis and theoretically can act as a reservoir, although it may not be present in Asia. It may be present in some crazy places in South America like Guyana, French Guyana, in the interior parts of it. And so it's theoretically possible that there's a vivax from there. These are really the exceptions, I mean, remarkable exceptions. Speaking to your question about immune tolerance, there's no question that blood stage malaria does cause some sort of immune tolerance that prevents clearance of the parasite. It has to do with mechanisms with dendritic cells, and there's actually a small but potent area of research in that area. As far as even in sporozoites, there's probably some sort of tolerance in epitope, sort of bait and switching that a woman named Magda Plabansky in Australia has come up with, which is hasn't really been appreciated well enough. I think those are at least a couple of your questions. I can't remember the rest of them because there were a bunch. The sickle cell. Oh, the sickle cell. So Rick Fairhurst and his group at the NIH recently have come up with a reasonable model for both how sickle hemoglobin and hemoglobin C contribute to ameliorating but not preventing malaria. What they do is when they're present in heterozygotes in populations, they allow people to get to reproductive age, okay? So in other words, if you have a homozygous sickle cell hemoglobin, you have sickle disease, you will die before reproductive age. But nonetheless, in parts of West Africa, 25% or more people have at least one allele of sickle hemoglobin. And the mechanism of that has been reported over the last couple of years and seems to be related to both in hemoglobin S heterozygotes and hemoglobin C heterozygotes, that the ability of the falciparum to form adhesive knobs on its surface is actually impaired. So there's somewhere between 30 and 60% of the normal number of adhesive knobs on the surface of the parasite. And that seems at least to be a reasonable explanation for why malaria is less severe. But it doesn't mean they don't get malaria. It means that they don't die from malaria. And on a population biology basis, that means those people can live to reproductive age. So those are published in Nature and PNAS.
I think the question with respect to hemoglobinopathies was whether we might be able to gain some insights from those into effective intervention strategies. And I think probably the answer to that is no, and in particular, the evolutionary experiment has already been done. So every one of these hemoglobinopathies HBS, HBC, probably the thalassemias, G6PD deficiency, all have significant deleterious impact, even in the heterozygotes. And what that probably tells us is that there is no intervention that is sufficient to control malaria that is not, would not preclude, say, the FDA from approving a drug that had a similar effect.
I think people have focused on a few antigens historically, and these are the antigens that were first identified, and they were first identified because they're the most abundant antigens on the parasite. And there's a reason for this, because the parasite uses those to shield itself from the immune system. So targeting those antigens is actually not the smartest thing to do. And I think the whole exercise going through selecting surface proteins that are very much exposed to the immune system as vaccines is futile, because evolution has shown us already that this is not a way to go. And I think we need to identify new targets that are actually not so dominant on the parasite surface or in other places in the parasite. But that's why I like the whole parasite idea, because you have everything right there. It's a vaccine, the whole thing is a vaccine. You don't have to select antigens, you just have to make sure it doesn't cause disease.
If you go door to door in a half a dozen different villages, which is what we've done, and you do active surveillance for blood smears, this is in a place where there's less than one infected bite per year, you know, for sure, and less than 1 in 1,000 mosquitoes is infected. 3 to 6% of people in this extremely low transmission area, 3 to 6% of people in every single one of these villages has asymptomatic parasitemia. Okay? So people in Africa, everybody believes this dogma that you have to have lots of infections for long periods of time, and by the time you hit puberty, if you survived, you're immune. Okay? So that's wrong in South America. It just is. It's not the observation. It's true for Africa in a place where there's intense transmission. It is not true for much of Southeast Asia. It's not true for the Philippines, I'm sure, if you actually looked. And it certainly isn't true for the entire Amazon basin, because this has been found first in Brazil, and we found the same thing in Peru. So that's an epidemiological observation. What the beautiful thing is, this is actually, it's like the game Jeopardy. We have the answer, now what's the question? So the answer is yes, you can become clinically immune. We know actually that AIDS doesn't reverse that clinical immunity, so it's not really completely T-cell dependent even. So it has to do with other parts of the immune system, probably the spleen's involved. But what's the mechanism by which we get asymptomatic parasitemia? That's actually, and you, I think if people knew how many people have seen that question and simply have not understood it, because this is the state of the art today, basically almost nobody really asks that question. That's the question. In my mind, it's one of the most important questions. How can you induce it with a subunit vaccine? I'm not sure. Can you do it with irradiated whole, asexual stage parasites? It's actually easier actually to grow asexual parasites in blood than probably sporozoites and mosquitoes, but basically cooking up gallons of irradiated asexual stage parasites to give it a vaccine is kind of an unseemly and probably impractical thing to do. So that's why people look for subunit vaccines. Can you just imagine the buckets of blood you'd have to be culturing? But there is a clinical observation, and we don't, and we see this. If you go, I showed a picture of Malian villages. If you go to most of the villages where there's intensive transmission in Kenya, 100% of people there have parasitemia that maybe you can only see by looking at a blood smear for an hour or by doing PCR. But that means they're clinically immune and they have a protective immune response. Don't we all want to know what the mechanism of that is? Because that's what we want to replicate. So that's what you can really, observations like that, that's what you can learn in the field. Why you can have boatloads of antibodies around that may or may not help for that, that's a hard thing to speculate on. But that was the comment I wanted to make, but kind of putting together one thread of this discussion.
Thank you very much. My name is Frederick Barireine. I'm a postdoc working with Dr. Nguyen Yan. Mine is some point of worry or even a comment. First of all, I did veterinary medicine before coming into malaria work, but I would like to mention that when I was young, I suffered so many bouts of malaria that my prayer was that when I grow up at some stage, I wanted to contribute toward the eradication of malaria. when that was my childhood dream. So I want to believe that malaria is eradicatable even during my lifetime. Even if I'm to die, I will die believing it's going to be eradicated soon after I die. My problem is the observation or the reality that when there is an effort to completely clear parastemia from individuals, then it's like you increase their susceptibility to infection and probably increase mortality. But at the same time, what I know is that most of the deaths from malaria are not necessarily due to infection with malaria, but due to poor or failure of early diagnosis and treatment. Yes. So I think if people look at that from that perspective, that if we are to embark on this plan, we should put in place all around effort, like what is being done in Thailand, to make sure that there are mechanisms of prompt diagnosis and treatment. Otherwise, the fact that there is any level of parastemia, from the immunological perspective, we could say that, okay, we should accept some people to maintain parastemia, but at the same time, it is also known that malaria's parastemia has got an effect on child brain development and ultimate academic performance. So at the end of it all, you find that in the long term, you are affecting the future generations by tolerating some parastemia at some level. We also have problems of malaria inducing abortion, causing anemia in pregnant women, and also interfering with other vaccines. So actually, malaria itself is a cause. I mean, it's like it complicates or it facilitates other infections, because by interfering with vaccines, causing anemia and ultimately the immune system being affected, by not knocking out the malaria parasite, you are also like indirectly facilitating other diseases. So my approach or my thought would be really, in view of what Dr. Hans Herren is advocating for, what I really have all come to believe is that malaria is basically a disease of poverty and a cause of poverty. I believe that if poverty is eliminated and the standards of living are enhanced, then the goal of eradication of malaria can be achieved, just as it has been in the West. What happens, like the slide that Dr. Guyan showed, is that most of these people have got a lot of bites from malaria, from mosquitoes, because of even the poor housing and poor drainage facilities. If the Western or the developed countries put it on their agenda to develop, because the United States, for example, deliberately helped to develop some countries. So, and we also know that the most hard hit area, which is Africa, is not because Africa is really poor. Look at the country like the Democratic Republic of Congo. It has got a lot of minerals, but if you look at what is happening in some of these countries, you can find that the late president of the Congo was richer than the country. And so if there are some policies also to help to develop these countries and also emphasize on political will, I think that can happen. Because I know if the developed countries insisted that some of these leaders are accountable to the people, I think there will even be some saving of money which the taxpayers, like from the developed countries, are putting in, when actually most of that money is like just being squandered. So I think if there is an effort also, some pressure and awareness maybe among even the politicians, I think this goal can be achieved, because the countries that are really suffering are not necessarily poor. They have the minerals, but they have
leadership which does not care about the people. So the approach is just thinking that maybe we can do just research and what, but it is, even this research can end up being frustrated because the infrastructure is not there and there's lack of some kind of will from some areas. So I think there's need also to look at these from that kind of general perspective. If we say that we should not knock out the parasites, we are also making those people susceptible to other infections, you know, and we are also a suspect, their brains are being affected and all that. So the fear of lack of immunity shouldn't be there as long as there are systems of prompt diagnosis and treatment. Thank you very much. That's how I was able to survive many of these bouts because I was living in a hospital. And whenever I could get a bout of malaria, I was promptly diagnosed and treated. Thank you.
Just brief comment about the diagnosis. I think the other group that worked on malaria realized that how prompt diagnosis is very important. And but I'm not going to discuss this here because it can be another day about we discuss about the diagnosis because in different area require different type of diagnosis, although the very basic proof of malaria infection still be microscope. But in certain country, to maintain the skill of microscopic is very difficult. So that's why they move on to many rapid point of care diagnosis, which also has so many pitfalls too. So anyway, I agree that prompt diagnosis will reduce the mortality for sure.
I just wanted to ask the panel members about, we've heard a lot about these high-tech, good, wonderful research tools that people are developing, but there are existing examples of lower cost, lower technology interventions which have proven successes, and I can bring forth just a few cases from Mexico in the 80s, then the work that PAHO is doing, that's the Pan-American Health Organization in Central America, case from Vietnam, case from Kenya, where there are lower tech solutions which involve communities, which involve good infrastructure development. And just wanted to know if those examples can help bring lessons for African cases outside of Kenya, because the Kenyan case has been mentioned several times. Some arguments exist that these examples are not relevant to the African case. So just wanted to know if those lessons from outside of Africa, which have proven successes with such lower cost and more sustainable long-term solutions, can be translated to the African continent.
I would use Thailand as a good example. You know, Thailand used to be a representative country of have very good control malaria, and that's why we keep the malaria prevalence low. But then the problem happened when the governments think that the malaria is not the problem anymore. So they pulled a major effort to control malaria out, and then we came back to a certain area that have malaria increased, and some unstable political issue in certain part of the country also contribute for that. You're right in terms of many control that already exist, we can implement and keep the prevalence lower. But that effort need to come from all parts. You know, like the community will well accept in Thailand, but they need support from the government and the Ministry of Public Health Officer, you know, have to maintain the capability to do all tasks. It's just not like one person retired, for example, like Thailand, cases from Thailand reported by slight reading. So every patient that come to malaria clinic will prove that they get malaria by slight reading. And that that is the best method or gold standard for diagnosis. But nowadays, it's many places. You know, you cannot maintain the skill at that level because the malaria is low, although it's not eradicated yet, but it's low. So the skill, the new technician, doesn't know much about how to differentiate among all four species. And if you are not only the PF malaria, you know that the treatment for falciparum and non-falciparum is different. And that have a lot of impact in terms of maintaining the transmission in nature. So I think the problem of the control is the technique available is not that bad, but it cannot be implemented in the same level in everywhere because of the other environmental issue.
Currently, we know that we have two very effective tools, that is the indoor residue spraying and ITNs, long-lasting nets, which have been shown to have impact on malaria prevalence and incidence. But we have often forgotten that what we are doing with those two strategies is just to control the adult mosquitoes. We forget that these mosquitoes have come from somewhere, and that somewhere is a larval habitat. And our studies shows that 90% of larval habitats where mosquitoes, Anopheles mosquito breed, are normally man-made, which means that the communities that have made those habitats can easily access them and control. And we, as ICPE, we are trying to revive the issue of larval control, including environmental management, because we know that in the past, environmental management worked very well, for example, in Egypt and Brazil and elsewhere, in terms of controlling the mosquitoes at source. And therefore, we believe that by involving the communities to understand where mosquitoes are coming from, to understand that they are the ones who are creating the problem, their own problems, and that they can easily solve their own problems, is the first step to reducing the number of adult mosquitoes that are coming into the houses. And therefore, I agree with you that those simple tools, I think we should revisit and try to kind of propagate that it is not only reliance on ITNs and IRS that can work, but we still have other simple technologies that were neglected because of, as we said, the eradication campaign, and that we should revisit them and involve the communities in terms of taking them up or ownership of those strategies. So I agree with you that the two tools that are currently available, and as Tom mentioned, it's very, very soon that we are going to develop, our mosquitoes are going to develop resistance. And once we got resistance, then we are kind of back to square one in terms of lack of effective control strategies. So we should, as I said earlier, have a holistic approach to vector control or malaria control.
Thank you. And I agree with John that there is tremendous potential in a number of the other interventions that we can see around, particularly around larval control and many other ideas that are working its way through. The issue that we see, though, from the perspective of vector control in this area is that the interventions that we know about, IRS and ITNs, have been the subject of a long and extensive study to establish their epidemiological impact. And we know that the team in ICPE are doing this kind of thing for larval control. Unfortunately, we see a very large number of other interventions proposed on the basis of what is frankly poor science. And the thing that I would urge the panel and all of you folks who are growing up into this arena to insist on is that we should apply the standards of epidemiological soundness that we insist on for drugs and for the traditional vector control articles, and I'm sure we will insist on for vaccines, that we apply those same standards to the ideas of integrated vector management and to some of the other things that are floating around, because frankly, there's some nonsense floating around as well that needs to be properly challenged with science.
If we go back and borrow from the agriculture people, normally in agriculture you have what is called research and extension. In other words, they develop strategies, tools, and blah, blah, blah. And then there's a whole set of a group of people who then go to the farmers and actually help implement or spread these technologies to the farmers. Now, in health, we don't have this kind of thing. Perhaps we have community health workers, but these are not attached to research institutions. Community health workers are working for the governments and for the ministers of health. So we lack a connect between research institutions and the so-called communities. We may sit here and talk about ideally we should engage communities, but we don't have a way. So this is an area that seriously needs to be addressed, so that, you know, whereas traditionally we do research and publish, I think it's very important that when research is accepted, peer-reviewed, and possibly even published, then there should be some way to have it delivered to the end user in the communities in a way that is consumable. And until we do that, then there's a serious gap between research and practice.
Yeah, I take a bit of a different angle here, and I would challenge also a bit WHO, Global Fund, RBM, maybe PMI, I mean, because these are the people who actually have the money and who decide what's going on in the field. And they have a very narrow view of what needs to be done. They know it all. They don't really ask a wider population around, people who know something about malaria or been out in the field. And certainly, personally, I resent very much, you know, that some of these people sit in offices and make decisions, having no clue what's going on out there in the field. And in particular, WHO, who had the, they're calling meetings where they don't even turn up themselves. So, because they know better, right, already. So, I was there 2 days ago on a major meeting on DDT again. The Global Fund, they made up their minds already what they're going to fund. So, they obviously have people who are advisors who know it very well. RBM was pretty much a disaster, maybe a bit better now, but still. And the PMI, again, very narrow views. So, and that's where all the money actually is. So if you want to do something different, well, you're going to have to look for your own money. And that's why my own foundation, Tiny Foundation, is funding the work in two places in Kenya, in the highlands and on the coast, to actually implement IVM. And there are data, but we don't have the might and the money to publish a lot of stuff, because of some money, I mean, and do very large scale, although 30 square kilometers in each site are not small. And again, I think it's been shown that it works. But I think we need really to think a bit about, you know, how can we get the control away from some of these big organizations or get in there? I don't know. Maybe it's better to try to infiltrate them. I don't know how we can do that. So that's certainly an issue.
Thank you. I'm David Roos from University of Pennsylvania. And I wanted to concur with Joe's comment and thank the organizers for the group that they've assembled for this panel discussion in particular. It's very nice to be able to see representatives with experience from many different malaria endemic areas with very different experiences and sociological and health environments. And with that as a background, to pick up on a comment, I think it was from Dr. Kitur about health information management systems and the clear need to be able to integrate that information. We've heard complaints about the difficulty of even putting into place integrated vector management strategies that we know work. And clearly in the human health arena, this is an even greater problem. So with respect to your highlighting the importance of integrated health management systems, what are the limiting factors that you see in Kenya or in Thailand or the Philippines or elsewhere to seeing better integration across the board? Clearly the parasites know no boundaries, the vectors know no boundaries, the humans probably know no boundaries, but human political and health management systems do.
The barriers that I think prevent the implementation of health systems is because the policymakers or decision makers are narrow-minded in the sense that they want to work with proven technologies, they want to be seen that they're implementing what maybe WHO is recommending, because WHO is like the pace setter for most of the Ministry of Health programs. And I see this as a problem of the generation gap, whereby the people who are in decision-making process, they are the old generation type that don't believe in ICT, for example. Now, if we have the younger people now take up some of these portfolios, I think they believe in ICT, they believe in information technology, and they can easily package this and make it a policy document for the government to approve that this is a priority area that needs to be implemented and put in place before any intervention can be implemented. Because right now we are implementing bedness, we're implementing ITNs, and people are saying that there's an impact on those two. But how they come up with facts and figures to say it is 20% reduction, no one knows. It's like hypothetical figures that they're giving out or they're dishing out just to please the donors that the money that's coming from Global Fund is working. So I think we need a system in place that is still lacking because of, as I said, the generation gap, and we need to kind of bring a young generation up who are involved in technology, development, and systems. And once we do that, then I think we shall be on the right track.
I think we need better models. I think integrated models, which can actually, you know, look at the health sector, within the health sector, the malaria and obviously other major problems, and then link this up with other sector of the environment, economy, and society. And such models are very rare. Actually, we're building one now at ECIPE, and the Millennium Institute together with ECIPE is trying to pull together a model where policymakers can then look at the consequences of certain decisions. This is important. And the thing is that it's not something you have to go and ask a question and get an answer in 2 weeks, something we can get a response in 5 seconds because you play scenarios out on a model which runs on a laptop. And basically that's what, and integrated models. And again, important where the feedback loops are in there and where you can look at the consequences and also then highlight synergies, because there are a lot of synergies to be gained when you do things in a certain way. And I think that's also very important. And when you have synergies, you're going to have savings. And again, we go back to money here. You know, how much money do health ministries have to spend versus other ministries? So you can see, you know, if you're the prime minister, you're going to have to make sure everybody's got some money, so they're fighting with each other, who gets more. And again, you can then play out such scenarios, and then everyone can see what the possible consequences may be. So tools, ability of tools, which have been built with the people concerned, because so they have to understand them, I think is one major problem to actually implement more integrated programs in the health sector, but as well as in other sectors, basically in the whole sort of national economy.
Yes, it's definitely a deliverable for the Global Fund project in the Philippines to establish a malaria information system. But of course, we also have the field health information system, though. So we really have to integrate the malaria information system into that. But the experience about information system is that it's only, most of the time, it's only for the benefit of those at the upper level. Information is not being feedback to those who are actually collecting and gathering the data. And these people should also understand the importance why they have to collect all of this information. And then what is the maybe very simplified explanation or analysis and explanation about the data, which they can apply as they're doing their daily responsibilities at their level. So I think that's the main problem, is that it's only one way. Information is only going one way, and it should be also going down for it to work and be sustainable.
Fred's really compelling personal comments about how he was able to survive better through his growing up because he was so close to a hospital and was able to get early diagnosis. I mean, that's quite informative for us who don't live in these areas to realize how important that can be. And Jetsman, you mentioned that it is an important issue, and actually implementation may be a problem. Because maybe it takes some degree of training in order for the people to be able to carry out these tests. But that kind of contradicts the discussions I've had with Guyen, because for his field work, he uses a kit product that maybe it's good for his field research, but maybe it doesn't apply so well to your clinical practice. So I'm having a lot of questions about diagnostics. And then I have another question still related to diagnostics, but that's clinical. That's all of that is clinical diagnostics related to managing sick patients and doing differential diagnosis. But then there would be another type of diagnostic that would be public health related and monitoring the population. And that kind of a test might be different from the one that you would use in clinical practice. So I'm wondering if you've thought about what would be your if there is a problem here, are there problems in those two diagnostic areas? And if there are, what would be an ideal solution for both in both of those areas? Just think of what would be the perfect test. And
Since I'm involved with both, we have the project that right now validate the new tools, the new malaria diagnosis by using the DNA amplification base. But as you know, you cannot do PCR or nested PCR in the field. So we use a simpler technique, they call it loop isothermal amplification. So it's a kind of like amplify the DNA with one temperature. No need to purify the DNA. We are validate that one. But not because I'm interested in diagnosis. The first idea come because I have another project that work in malaria endemic village, and we pretty much looking for the person that carry the parasite that can infect the mosquito. So we found that in this village, as related to the other study that you found, the majority of the villagers are acquired immune because we find the parasite, but it has no symptom. And the more important is that these people, even we cannot identify any gametocyte in their blood, some of them infect the mosquito. So they have a low level of gametocyte that we could not see by, you know, expert microscopists in my team. And then I came up to the idea that what could I identify more people that carry parasite in this village, because I want to know who else that carry the infectious gametocyte. And then come up with, because one of my colleagues who is molecular biology suggests that they have the new technique LAMP. So we're interested in that. So we test whether the technique feasible. If feasible, one is feasible, the bridge or learn about that. So they ask me if I can validate this for diagnosis. Then I learn a little bit more about the diagnosis. Why I need this test? Because we test the rapid diagnosis, all the chromatography base that available in the market that been used in many countries in Africa and claim that it's very good. It worked for the symptomatic one, for falciparum, for sure. But it doesn't pick up the non-symptom or a symptom that even have the same level of parasitemia, which is interesting. Why? We know that the chromatographic base based on the enzyme, specific enzyme, the parasite, is likely that even you see the same number, but maybe the enzyme of the parasite that produces different in terms of the symptom and a symptom. And the second thing is that most of the rapid diagnosis pick up only falciparum. So they can claim only whether this patient has falciparum or non-falciparum. And it's worked well in most of the country in African continent with falciparum is the majority, right? And you treat that with falciparum. But in Thailand, we have 50% of VIVAX. And the treatment is completely different because Thailand is a the region of multi drug resistant. So we will not use artisanate combination for all cases. So we select only falciparum with artisanate and still use chloroquine, primaquine for non-falciparum. So that's why it's important that we have to be able to differentiate the parasite, and rapid diagnosis doesn't work in this country. It's also implied that to many other countries besides Africa, like China. The mainland China in the central part is purely VIVAX. Korea is purely VIVAX. If you look at the number, for example, in China, how many cases of malaria that become falciparum and VIVAX, in fact, they have more VIVAX than falciparum. But it's not being reported, that's all. Because I have another project in China. And diagnosis become the big issue because when I work in Thailand, I thought that every country in the world also use blood smear to identify malaria. I learned that in India, in certain area, they just use a symptom. If you're so sick like this, they said you are falciparum. If you're not that sick, it's VIVAX, which is not true in Thailand. You cannot differentiate from the symptom. So that's why diagnosis, rapid diagnosis become more and more hot topic too. If you're looking for the fashion, that can be another field that get more funding now because the very good diagnosis for malaria is besides microscopic, which is considered cheap, can do it in many places, but you have to have the expert to do that. You know, not everyone can see the parasite and say there's a species. Dr. Kebe visited my lab recently. He can tell you later how he enjoyed to see the parasite that my technician said that it's plenty, and he said that he saw nothing. Even he worked with malaria too. So that's the case, you know. So diagnosis issue is depend on the country. African country is also a good place. They have a lot of malaria, but I understand that they require rapid diagnosis because the microscopist is not readiness in every area. So that's why I think for symptomatic, when anyone go to the diagnostic area, keep in mind that we have two group of malaria. The one that gets sick with malaria, we call symptomatic, and I confirm that most of the rapid diagnosis for falciparum work. Another group for in terms of public health sector that want to do the surveillance, you know, you have to go to either PCR or microscopic because the rapid diagnosis is terrible. It didn't pick up what's supposed to pick up. We proved that, why. We have to go for other assay.
Yes, we still depend on the thick and thin blood smears, both for epidemiology and for diagnosis. Because of that, we have to train village microscopists to do the job because they reside in the area. But of course, we really have to maintain them because most of it is voluntary work. Many of them, they receive only about $12 a month monetary return for doing the job. But the problem would be if they get an offer which will give them more income, then they will certainly choose that that one instead of remaining in doing microscopy. So we lose some of them. So we have to do retraining again for those who will join the program at the local level. We call this community-based microscopy, so that the patient does not have to go a long way to be able to be diagnosed and treated correctly. But the problem is that antimalarials are very much accessible in any place in the Philippines, even in the small store or anywhere in the market. So people have gotten used to taking antimalarial for any symptom, headache, abdominal pain. they take antimalarial. So many times the microscopists would find it very difficult to see the parasite if they have taken. So that's this antimalarial. So it's really a problem if we depend only on being able to detect the parasite by microscopy. So the other alternative is the rapid diagnostic test, which should be able to detect the antigen of the parasite or the enzyme LDH, even if there are no more parasites that the microscopist can detect. So we really have to take into consideration these difficulties with regards to diagnosis. So for the clinical, you mentioned about our clinicians. They depend on microscopy, but then they can ask the patient to come back. Like, I remember that I was making blood smears, and this patient has no fever at that time. So for public health work, I will just have to do one blood smear. So it's very good that that time I stayed for a while. Then he developed high grade fever in the afternoon while I was still in the area. So I did another blood smear, and the parasites were detected. So there is some sequestration or synchrony in the release of the parasites so that you can detect them. This is another consideration that we have to think about also. So we may be able to miss them because of the timing in the collection of the blood. So I have seen some other problems which maybe skip my mind now, but yeah, I agree with you that there are several problems with regards to diagnosis. Maybe we should think about them also in development of other diagnostic methods. Yeah. Yes.
Okay, so we've come across this problem in Western Kenya where we work, and you know, we occasionally we go around small clinics and hospitals and see what sort of records they have. And in a few cases, we've come across records which suggest that actually 60 to 70% of the fevers are not due to malaria. Now, fortunately, in those clinics, they had microscopes, and so they were able to distinguish between what you call pyrexia of unknown origin and pyrexia due to malaria. Now, where there's no microscopy, it means that all those cases are actually treated as malaria, simply because if it is malaria and you ignore it, it is potentially fatal. So you go ahead and treat, because the drug will not harm you anyway. But you consider that the drug actually it's about $7 for an adult. For a 15-year-old, it's about $3.5, and for a young child, it's about $1.5. Now, currently, the cost of a rapid diagnostic kit, a single strip, is worth about $1. So actually, the policy was that no one should be treated until they've been tested with a rapid diagnostic kit. But I think the problem then was that these kits were a bit expensive, about $2, $1.5, and people are not familiar with them. There is a certain amount of overdiagnosis, especially when it's based on enzymes, because some of these enzymes can hang around for a long time, even after the parasites are dead. But still, when you do the mathematics, you find that it's actually economical to test every case, because if you misdiagnose, you're going to end up paying a lot of money. So this should be enforced, that where there's no microscopy, they should use rapid tests.
I just want to compare malaria to cancer and some of the really amazing developments that have happened in the cancer field over the past few years, where, for example, a disease like chronic myelogenous leukemia used to be fatal, and now you can take Gleevec, which essentially rescues it, gives no symptoms, or, you know, there's very few side effects, and basically people are now living a very happy life with this disease. And I wonder if this whole discussion that we're having about eradication is somewhat dangerous, because it tends to give funders, politicians, and so forth this idea that we know everything about the parasite and we know everything about malaria, and that there's actually no point in doing further basic research when in fact we could possibly develop the magic bullet that would solve all our problems and would lead to eradication. And whether we're just sort of, you know, engaging in kind of a, you know, assuming that we have to put all of our money into translation at this point instead of actually going back and trying to figure out how the parasite works at a detailed level.
Well, I completely agree, you know, but I thought that because of the effort that will enhance more seeding funding to the basic research, because we have so many things that we don't know about the parasite. For example, very simple, you know, the vaccine that has not been so successful yet, the basic question is that do we have a very simple surrogate marker to screen the efficacious of the vaccine, I mean the real one. You know, instead of wait until you go to human trial and see it fail. And it's a lot of money to work just one vaccine to go to human trial before you realize that it failed and take time. So if we can have a better system, that's the first thing. But to understand that, you need more basic research done on immunology. And since I'm not immunologist, so I know that it's a big field open, you know, for that. In terms of transmission itself, even we say that the transmission blocking vaccine is look promising, but we also find out new things almost every day about what happened when the parasite entered into the mosquito. And different species of the mosquito also behave differently against different parasites, you know, and in the country like Thailand that we have more than 16 enough the species that potentially be the vector. We already know four of them is the main vector, and we have four parasites, and maybe having the fifth parasite soon or something like that. So is that make the transmission of malaria is more thing to learn, you know? We even have a joke that the falciparum vaccine going to come soon, and then they move to YVAX because of the E word. And I think that once we study falciparum YVAX, and then it will turn to Ovale, the third one, that very similar to YVAX, and we sometimes misdiagnose that in Thailand. It may turn to the third species, so it will be more and more, you know, to understand all of these. And we require more basic research to do this.
I believe that we know a lot already than before with all of these new sciences now, but maybe we're missing some important things about the interaction between the parasite and the human host. Because remember, these are parasites. So they won't be parasites if they're not successful, if they kill the host very fast, and then they will not survive and perpetuate their species. So maybe we're missing some more things on the interaction part between the host response and to the parasite. But I'm sorry, I cannot tell you now. Maybe we have to think about that.
We have an ethical issue here, because we know how to control malaria. It's not that we don't know. So why don't we do what we know how to do while research goes on? As I said before, I think we need to let people do research, but should not detract from doing as much as we can to actually reduce and eliminate, if possible, malaria with what with the tools we've got, and we have them, as I said before. It's been shown before that it can be done. So if we find a better tool later on, okay, if it's still needed. And all this research, as a lot of the research, can find uses sooner or later. So I think it's not one or the other. I think it's really emphasize that there are people dying out there today, that there's a lot of morbidity, the malaria and other diseases are holding back development. And we can't wait, because there's 2.5 billion more people coming, and they also, I think, need to grow into a world where there is less trouble. So, it's not one or the other. We need to move on with different things. Different people have to do different things, again, also. And as I said, I think it depends where the money comes from. And it's sure that a lot of the money, which is pretends to be for development, goes into basic research. That's not correct. I think one has to really make sure that there are agencies who are funding basic research, and that's where that money should come from for doing a lot of the important work which needs to be done still in malaria, while we do what we can to alleviate the problem in the field as much as we can.
I just want to say three things, I think, that I heard distinctly today that perhaps you can take away as take-home lessons in here. So we heard a very strong plea for the availability of health information systems. I mean, I think that this is a theme that came up over and over and over again. So this really strikes to or addresses this issue of excellent vertical communication, and as we hear, both up and down and then laterally. And so the diagrams that Dr. McLean showed about what they're developing with the IVCC is really, I think, a major effort in that area. And I think that you'll probably get lots of calls about the models that you're developing there, because it's exactly what I think people were talking about here. In fact, you didn't go up and down, you had a circle of the way these models are being developed. We also heard very, very strongly, that the general feeling is that we've got to use the tools we have while we're making new things, period. And what that means is that we've got to fight very strongly against this idea of sequestering knowledge and resources in one compartment of this whole effort if we're expecting to have any impact at all. And so that importantly for the people working in the room here, working with malaria, we're not competing against each other. We're competing against a pathogen and a disease. And we need to keep that in mind. Now, having said that, with limited resources, There are going to be issues, but I think Dr. Heron pointed out that there are agencies that deal with different parts of the pathway, so to speak, and I'll use some vernacular here, that has to go discovery, development, and delivery, and that there are agencies that deal with discovery, NIH, for example, and then we're working with translational agencies that are interested in the development and delivery, and we need to keep that in mind and support each other in those various venues. I think that's extremely important. And then on a sort of technical level, we heard something which wasn't heavily addressed today, which is just how significant diagnostics is actually. And it strikes to this issue of eradication and the fact that we have parasitemic people who are asymptomatic. And these are major, these are the reservoirs. The mosquitoes aren't going to be the reservoirs. The people are the reservoirs. And so with any hope of eradication, we have to deal with this essentially parasitized population that doesn't have disease systems, disease symptoms, because this is where the actual front on a major effort for eradication is likely to take place. Anyway, I'd like to thank you all. This has been a long and very informative day. We'd like to thank once again Liz Easton and the Newkirk Center for making this possible. And I think we can adjourn now. Thank our panel, and we can adjourn now then.